Hey everyone, and welcome back to the channel. In this video, we'll be looking at a practice example on how to calculate the elasticity of demand with just the demand equation and some change in price. And in this case, it'll be a price decrease. With that said, let's get into it. So here I have my demand function, which you can see is denoted as QD equals 500 minus 10p, and I have some change in price. And in this case, it's a reduction in the price from $15 to $5. Now, using just this information, I can calculate what's called the elasticity of demand, which measures my responsiveness in quantity demanded to that price change, in this case, that decrease of $10. So the first thing I need is my formula for elasticity, which remember is the change in Q over Q divided by the change in P over P. So what I teach my students is to then take note of all of the information that I need to know. So my P1, my P2, my Q1, and my Q2. And this is essentially my original price, my new price, my original quantity, and my new quantity. Now you might notice right away that I have some information that's given to me right in the question. And that is my original price and my new price. So let me fill those in first. My original price was $15, and you can see that's given to me in the question. And then my new price, P2, is $5. But I don't have my Q1 or my Q2. All I have is my demand function. And so what I'm going to do is to find Q1, I will substitute P1 into the demand equation and solve for QD. And when I do that, I get something that looks like this, 500 minus 10 times 15. Simplifying further, I get Q1 is equal to 500 minus 150, and then obviously Q1 must be 350. To find Q2 is very similar. I'm just going to substitute in P2 into the demand equation and solve for Q. If I do this, I get an equation that looks like this, 500 minus 10 times 5. Upon further simplification, I get 500 minus 50. And then finally, I can do this simple subtraction to get Q2 is equal to 450. So now I'm going to substitute those into my known values since I've now calculated for them. Here's the part that students find most confusing, actually substituting these four values into the equation. And so what I like to teach is that instead of saying change in Q over Q or change in P over P, you can simply think of it as the new value minus the old value over the old value. And so let's see what that looks like when I substitute in my values. So I have new Q minus old Q over old Q. And all of that is on top of new P minus old P over old P. So again, 450 is my new Q. I subtract the old Q, which was 350, and then I divide all of that by the old Q of 350. Similarly, the new price is $5. I subtract the old price, so new minus old, which is $15, and then I have all of that over 15. Now all I need to do is simplify. Yes, it looks confusing, but it's not that complicated. The next line is going to give me 100 over 350. That's just 450 minus 350, which is 100. And then 5 minus 15, which is negative 10, over 15. And you'll notice that both the top and the bottom fractions can both be reduced. So that's my next step. I can reduce 100 over 350 to 2 over 7, and I can reduce 10 over 15 to 2 over 3, and of course that negative sign comes along for the ride. So now I've got 2 sevenths over 2 thirds. And that might seem confusing because we have a fraction over another fraction, but we know that we can turn this into a multiplication problem by simply multiplying by the reciprocal. So I have my negative 2 sevenths on the top, and instead of dividing by 2 thirds, I can turn it into a multiplication problem if I flip the 2 thirds over for its reciprocal of 3 halves, 3 over 2. Now I can just multiply top times top, bottom times bottom. Now if I do this, I'm going to get 6 over negative 14. Again, don't really overthink if that negative goes on the top or the bottom. You can have it out front on the top or the bottom. It doesn't change the fact that the fraction is negative, so don't really stress about that part. I'm going to reduce this one more time to give me negative 3 over 7, and that is my elasticity. Now, some people don't like leaving it in a fraction because it stresses them out that it's not a decimal, and that's up to your instructor or your teacher whether you are required to keep it as a fraction or write it as a decimal, but we can write it as a decimal rounded to the nearest 100th, just so you can see what that looks like. Now, if I round this to the nearest 100th, it ends up being approximately negative 0.43. We know that elasticity of demand will always be negative, so when we want to determine if this is inelastic or elastic, we look at the absolute value. So we can actually ignore that negative sign. The negative sign will always be there for a normal good because as price goes up, quantity demanded goes down and vice versa as per the law of demand. So looking at the absolute value, we get approximately 0.43, and we know that this is obviously less than 1. And because it's less than 1, we would call this inelastic. Once again, if that answer was more than 1, it would be elastic. If it was exactly 1, it would be unitary elastic. but because it is in fact less than one, we would call it inelastic. We hope that you found this video helpful, and if you did, let us know by liking the video, subscribing to the channel, and of course, let us know what sort of economic topics or homework questions you'd like to see us cover in the future. Thanks for watching this video, and we'll catch you in the next.